It's not news that there are many outstanding land claims with First Nations across Canada. But when the subject of land claims comes up, there's often a tendency to jump to the wrong conclusions.
It isn't always the bad news. It isn't always what sensationalized a roadblock or an OCA. It is the small success stories or large success stories that are happening for the betterment of all people.
When claims are directly connected to specific wrongs from the past, they are called specific claims. Many of these specific claims relate to historic treaties, the text for which can be found here at Library and Archives Canada.
Since the early 1700s, the British and later Canadian governments entered into various treaties with First Nations across the country. This helped to pave the way for the peaceful settlement and development of much of Canada.
A specific claim comes about by a wrong that was committed by the federal government many years ago, or it could be part of a treaty that has not been fulfilled.
A specific claim would be where the First Nation did not receive the land it was entitled at the time of treaty, or in another occasion where there would have been a mismanagement of funds.
They are outstanding legal obligations, and by law, by Canadian law, you have to settle these obligations. So that's why the federal government has recognized the need to settle these obligations through negotiations.
The settlement of specific claims is done through negotiations, where parties come together to achieve a settlement that is a fair and equitable resolution for all parties.
One of the 330 First Nations in Canada to successfully conclude a claim through negotiations with the government is the Abenaki Nation in Quebec.
The government is in a position to acknowledge mistakes, sit down with a First Nation, and correct the mistakes.
I think the other communities can find inspiration in what we did and see that it is possible to reach an agreement in which both parties are satisfied.
But when the obligations of the past are honored, what is the impact on third parties? When a claim is settled, are private landowners at risk of losing their land?
People are concerned that they're going to lose their land when a claim is settled. They think that the government is going to come and take their land. Well, that's not true.
What we do, we provide financial compensation to First Nations. And if they buy lands, it has to be on a willing seller, willing buyer basis.
Take, for example, the historic agreements reached in Saskatchewan to deliver on treaty promises to provide reserve land. As a result, 33 First Nations received a total of $595.5 million in compensation, and about 800,630 acres of land have since been purchased by the First Nations on the open market and turned into reserve land in the province.
Everyone has benefited. The First Nations have benefited because they now have the land, and they've been provided with funds to make up for the lack of use of that land, which they've invested in businesses, which they've invested in economic activity, which they've invested in their own communities.
Many Saskatchewan First Nations continue to invest in local economies through land purchases and new business ventures, as is the case with English River.
And I think that the important part is the Aboriginal community sees that there's a tremendous importance in being in Saskatoon, that good things can happen here, that they're welcome here.
So if it's the word's out there in the business community that English River First Nation is a good company to do business with.
We can't live in isolation. First Nations are part of the economy. And when they are able to benefit from their own investment dollars, we all share in that benefit.
In British Columbia, the Skechestan First Nation is also creating its own successes by investing in health and education programs, community transportation, and new backyard gardens for its members.
We have helped numerous young people either get into trades or participate in college prep or just going back to school.
My brother and I do an organic vegetable delivery service to people in the general area. So we have about 30 customers and they just think it's great.
In Northern Ontario, the Michipotin First Nation has made similar investments with positive results and new local business partnerships on the horizon.
We have a lot more opportunity here. Everybody's working here. There's zero unemployment.
So it's been good to see the settlement done. We're talking on a forward-looking basis, and we recognize that for Mishpacha and its members, it's a big part of their future, or makes it a big part of our future.
The powerful sense of closure and hope for the future that settlements can generate is also evident with a recent settlement achieved with the Madawaska Maliseet First Nation in New Brunswick.
This claim was that it allowed the community to put to rest a long-standing issue, a grievance that they'd lived with since 1970, seeing a pipeline run through their community.
We don't forget the past, and we don't forget how we've come to be who we are, but we've also really focused on moving forward, and that to the point where that has become our motto.
It's a negotiated settlement, so everyone wins in that kind of a situation. The long-term benefit is that the claim has been resolved. The short-term benefit really is the healing that takes place within the community. They've finally been recognized, the wrong has been righted, and now they can move on.
We have to, at some point in time, let go of the past and work together as a nation to make it better for everybody.